Those are my names, and I'm going to be talking to you about peer learning in higher education. This is not a research, it is a synthesis of this model of teaching and learning in higher education. So I looked around for information on this, and I thought it is quite interesting to share it. And just before we came for this session this afternoon, I had a group of people who were asking me the role of graduate students in teaching undergraduates. And I thought it is just time that I share this kind of information. So I'm going to take you through very fast. I've been given very few minutes, but I want to begin by defining peer learning and peer teaching as an educational arrangement in which one student teaches one or more fellow students. The background to this is that the main goal of medical education is the progressive independence of the learner. And an important skill for becoming an independent learner is the ability to self-reflect. And a potential way to learn how to self-reflect is to teach oneself. And to teach oneself is by teaching others. So for one to be able to self-reflect, which is a very important component of medical education, is for that person to be able to teach others. Here we look at learning as an adjustment of networks and concepts, and this is done by accretion, which is adding information to what you already have. Restructuring, that is modification of what is in your mind. As we know, we are teaching adults, and adult learners usually come with a background knowledge, so many times they just restructure what they have. And then tuning, where there is adjustment for adequacy and efficiency. So learning is the adjustment of prior knowledge base, and teaching helps to do this. So when we use peers to teach others, there's a way it helps even the teacher to adjust and learn even better. So why do we want to talk about peer learning? We want to talk about peer learning because we know that learning is optimized if the distance between what is known and understood and what must be learned is just enough to stimulate active inquiry. And this comes in handy if you are looking at the distance between the learner and the teacher. Literature says that in learning there is what is described as the zone of proximal development, and this evokes a cognitive friction which has to be resolved. That means the learner has a difference in the knowledge that they have, and they want that gap to be resolved. And literature also shows that near peers sense this zone more easily than content experts. Meaning that if you are going to teach, it is much easier when you have a student or a graduate student teaching undergraduates, because they sense this zone more easily than the experts. The experts tend to assume so much and many times leave their students behind, because for them they get interested in what they are talking about and forget their students. The other thing about peer teaching is that junior students are anxious to know what lies ahead, and usually the near peers serve as good role models. Students need to have faith in their skills to acquire knowledge, and the best way for them to really be sure that they can acquire this knowledge is through their peers, because this helps reduce anxiety, it builds faith, and also fosters learning. Usually there is something we call the hidden curriculum, and this is largely transmitted by the older students to the young students. The hidden curriculum is those things in medical school which you are not going to find in textbooks. These are things you are going to see how your seniors model professional behavior, how they act around around patients, and these are things which are not in textbooks. Usually, students learn better from their peers when they are observing them practice. So what are the dimensions of peer learning? If you are a teacher, it is always good to know how do you arrange this to happen. In dimensions, we talk about the distance, what is the level between the teacher and the learner. And this one is categorized into what we call near peer teachers, where the teacher and learner are on the same level but differ by one or more years, like graduate student teaching undergraduates. Then we have cross-level teachers, when teachers are on a different level than the learners. Then we have another dimension of group size, you could have where there is one-to-one peer teaching, one student who is probably better, and I'm sure many of you have used this, can actually train the other. We have peer teaching in small groups, where there is a group of three and one person is taking them through, and then there's peer teaching in large groups. The other dimension is the formality. We've looked at the difference, we've looked at the group size, and then the formality. How is it arranged? Is it a formal arrangement? Is it an informal arrangement? So it could be that peers informally work together to prepare for classes or tests. This comes out clearly in tutorials, where they sit in a group and discuss and make a presentation. You could have student-led extracurricular activities such as conferences and symposia, or you could have peer teachers as an obligatory part of the education program. This, I think, is what happens in most schools where we have graduate students teaching undergraduates, but the question is this part of the curriculum? Can the graduate students be assessed for teaching the undergraduates? Do they benefit from this arrangement as graduate students? So what are the examples? I've already talked about these arrangements, and you need to look at the distance, the group size, and the formality. You could have students working together to prepare for a test. Usually these students are of the same year, so the distance is low. The size is usually small because it's a small group. It is an informal arrangement, so the formality is low. You could have personal coaching by an experienced senior. Maybe you have a fourth year medical student talking to third years. Or you could have a registrar talking to undergraduates, and the distance may be high. The group size is usually small and the formality is low. You may have senior medical students teaching groups of junior medical students. You have a class of fourth years being taught by graduate students. The distance may be high, a big group, and the formality is high if it is an arrangement of the teaching institution, and so on and so forth. In the interest of time, I'm going to skip the rest. But I wanted us to look at this as an effective way of learning, teaching being an effective way of learning, if we use this learning pyramid. If you remember this learning pyramid, it tells us that from the top to the bottom is where we have the auditory, the visual, and the kinesthetic, where there are demonstrations and discussions and practices. And normally, the learning and retention increases as you go downwards, meaning that the more you participate, the more you actually remember what you have learned. So when students demonstrate to others, they are able to retain 30%. When they discuss, when they practice, and when they teach others, they can actually retain up to 90%. What are the benefits of peer learning? One of the things we know is that in order for someone to teach, they must appreciate the subject. Therefore, they have to prepare. And this preparation enhances learning. These students also know that they are going to face a group, so they really prepare, because it has to have to be a face-to-face teaching. Verbalization also is an important way of learning. When someone knows a subject and they can talk about it, that's when we can actually appreciate that they know the subject, when they verbalize, when they vocalize what they know. It also creates self-confidence, and as they teach others, they gain self-confidence. What usually happens is that a person placed in a particular position tends to adapt his or her self-perception in accordance with the position. So whenever we get students to teach others, they tend to adapt the ways of the teachers, and therefore they prepare and try to be ready for this session because they will be asked questions. What are the benefits? The benefits of peer learning is that there is what we call intrinsic motivation. How does this come about? This intrinsic motivation comes in by competence. The student who is going to teach must be competent. The student feels autonomous because he has to prepare, and then he also feels related to the others that they are going to teach, including the ones who are listening into their tutor or their teacher who is their near peer, and therefore they learn better. Playing the role of a teacher may serve to create feelings in all these domains. That is the domains of competence, of autonomy, and relatedness. What about peer assessment? Peer assessment enhances your professional behavior, and it can measure and promote professionalism. Peers provide reliable and stable ratings of fellow peers and students, find peer assessment acceptable. If, for example, you use students to assess their fellow students, this has been found to be acceptable. Sometimes they have been used in OSCEs, where they act as simulated patients and then they give feedback. This has been found to be acceptable by the fellow students. How does peer teaching parallel with Maslow's hierarchy of needs? We all know this hierarchy of needs, from the very basic one, which is biology, to the highest, which is transcendence. And you find that when you look at the very basic ones, there is probably no relationship. But when you look at the level of belonging and love, which is basically about family, affection and relationships, a peer teacher feels there is satisfaction from individual peer counseling and being counseled by a peer. So there is a way that the teacher benefits when they practice teaching. It also builds their esteem. That is, they feel they have achieved something, they see they have a status in class, and they are able to teach. So there's satisfaction from having a teaching status and responsibility, and therefore the peer teacher benefits from this one. When it goes all the way up to transcendence, whereby you are looking at helping others self-actualize, like I was referring to the hidden curriculum, the students who are being taught and those who are learning feel the beauty of helping others self-actualize. In a way, you are sharing what you know and you feel that you are making your friends and your colleagues actually better. So I'd like to stop here and thank you for listening to me.